The Philippines and Australia mark 75 years of bilateral relations. Several programs are lined up to mark decades of good ties between both countries. And we have with us this morning Australian Ambassador Stephen Robinson. Ambassador, I'm glad you made it.
Thanks very much, Karen. It's lovely to be with you this morning. Thanks very much for having me.
All right. One of the keys in celebrating 75 years of diplomatic relations between both countries is strengthening civil and maritime security. You've said that Australia is a strong supporter of the Philippines' 2016 arbitral victory. How can the relationship between the Philippines and Australia even strengthen the arbitral victory of the Philippines in the South China Sea issue today?
Yeah, thanks, Karen. It's a very good question. So our relationship with the Philippines has been strong in defense and security and intelligence for a long, long period of time. And it's one of the pillars of the bilateral relationship. And so in our defense cooperation program, we do lots of training with the Philippines, and we confirmed in 2019 that we would continue that training support to the Philippines on an ongoing fashion. This year, as it is our 75th anniversary, we've also initiated a program on civil maritime security. And so this is working with the Coast Guard, with the Philippine National Police Maritime Group, also with the Department of Defense, to bolster Philippine maritime security, because we all recognize that cross-border security is the best way to look after our perimeter security of our countries. So Australia is going to cooperate extensively with the Philippines over the next 3 years.
All right. And is that right that Australia will be donating 6 patrol ships to the Philippines, among other things?
So not donating. We're currently in negotiation with Austal, which is the major shipbuilder here in the Philippines that's Australian and Filipino owned, and they're based down in Cebu in Balambang. Austal is currently working with the Department of Defense and the Navy to potentially build 6 offshore patrol vessels for the Navy. And we're very hopeful that that will come about and there will be a decision reached to construct those vessels, because they'd be constructed here in Cebu, in Balambang, in the Austal facility, which would bring a significant employment to the region. And it would really enhance the Philippines, particularly its shipbuilding industry. Already Austal does an enormous amount of work down there in Balambang, but this would really expand its facility enormously and bring a lot of benefit to the Philippines.
Yeah. Ambassador, you've said that Austal taking over the Hanjin shipyard in Subic may be finalized within the next month or two. So is there any progress regarding that? And how would Austal taking over the Hanjin shipyard actually make a difference in improving the country's maritime capabilities to protect the South China Sea or the West Philippine Sea interest?
So negotiations are progressing between Austal and a number of different parties. I'm hopeful always of an early conclusion to such negotiations, but I really don't know how long it will take. But if it was successful and Austal was able to secure the Hanjin shipyard in some form, then that would certainly enhance Austal's ability to become the shipbuilder of choice for the Philippines and indeed for the region, because the Hanjin facility is tremendous. It's one of the biggest shipyards in the world. And if Austal, together with others, was able to secure that, then that would potentially enable it to expand its operation considerably here in the Philippines and promote a range of shipbuilding activities in the Philippines and across the region.
Yeah. What do you make of China? You've said previously how Australia respects the results of UNCLOS, how it adheres to international law. But what do you make of China essentially not respecting these laws?
Well, Australia's always had a principled approach to law of the sea matters, and whether it be the South China Sea, the West Philippine Sea, or any international waters, what we essentially say is that there are rules and norms under which all countries should operate. And particularly centered around the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, we believe that that's quite fundamental. And if countries adhere to that, then we'll all be able to utilise those international waterways in a free and unimpeded way, because what we want is freedom of navigation, freedom of overflight, and unimpeded trade for us to travel through those waters. And in the case of the South China Sea and the West Philippine Sea, about 65% of Australia's maritime trade goes through that area. So we're asking all countries to adhere to those rules and norms and the UN Law of the Sea Convention.
Are you seeing in the future, if China is not contained, that trade would be a problem for many countries?
So we're just saying that everyone needs to follow those rules and norms. If we do that, there won't be an issue. But if countries step outside that and undertake other actions that aren't consistent with those rules, norms and the international convention, then that creates difficulties for everybody and uncertainty. And anything that creates uncertainty or tension around these international waterways is not good for anybody.
China just recently unilaterally imposed a fishing ban, unilaterally did this. Has the Philippines really acted and taken advantage of its allied countries like Australia in protecting its interests in the West Philippine Sea?
Well, I suppose, how the Philippines responds to that unilateral ban is essentially a matter for the Philippines. But it does come to, I suppose, the coalition of countries across Southeast Asia, and particularly ASEAN and Australia as part of Southeast Asia, to think about how we want those waterways to be governed and how we want them to work. So therefore, we all talk frequently about how do we utilize international waterways and how do we get the best from them. And so there's ongoing discussion between us and ASEAN, the Philippines, other countries in the region about how do we make the most of this and how do we ensure that we do hold to rule of law and the UN conventions.
You've said that Australia stands by the president's statement in the UN General Assembly when he affirmed the Philippines' victory against China. But then clearly, locally, there are differing statements. Does this create confusion to Australia, for example, so an allied nation of the Philippines, on where it stands with its foreign policy?
Thanks, Karen. Good question. So for us, I don't think so. Because I think what we look at and other international countries look at are the statements that are made internationally. And using fora like the United Nations General Assembly is a pretty critical place to make a statement about your country's foreign policy and its stance. So, when the president spoke at the UN General Assembly and he spoke about the West Philippine Sea and the South China Sea and the arbitral award, I think many countries around the world, all countries around the world, took heed of that and said, well, there you go, that is the Philippines' stance. And it was an outstanding speech, I must say. I've read it a number of times subsequently, and there is real substance to that speech and real meaning to it. And I think most countries took a great deal from that. And I know that there were many congratulatory comments that came following the president's speech to the UN General Assembly.
What are you seeing a stronger role that the visiting forces agreement between the Philippines and Australia will play in the coming years, given the situation in the West Philippine Sea? The VFA between two countries was ratified in 2012, and yet in the consciousness of many Filipinos, it's the VFA between the United States and the Philippines that's often in the news, so to speak. In other words, there's not a lot of consciousness between the visiting forces agreement with the Philippines and Australia.
Yeah, well, we have a memorandum of understanding that sets up our defence cooperation that goes back to 1995. And as you rightly say, we have a visiting forces agreement that was enacted in 2012. What that enables us to do is to come to the Philippines and to train side by side with our partners in the armed forces of the Philippines and to consider, the ways in which we would deal with various issues that might befall us. So what we've done is to utilise that agreement to good effect, to take Armed Forces of the Philippines personnel down to Australia to train them in our facilities, bring our Armed Forces personnel to the Philippines to do likewise, mm-hmm. because what we're looking at is interoperability and ability to cooperate together. And if our Armed Forces understand how we approach particular issues and how we approach our strategies, then that enables us to cooperate more effectively. So it's worked very, very well for us. We do not trumpet this. It's just a good part of our bilateral cooperation and a critical element of our bilateral relationship with a key partner and ally, which is the
All right. Yeah. Australia's participation in the Philippines COVID response. I know that Australia has donated millions of dollars to assist several hospitals in strengthening the country's COVID response, even in donating PPEs and also medical equipment as well. What are you seeing in terms of cooperation with vaccination? You are seeing the struggle of the country in terms of vaccines coming in, trickling in much slower than expected, and herd immunity has been announced that it might be delayed, right? We won't be reaching the target of December, wherein Australia and New Zealand are practically open to each other already at this point in time. So is there any kind of cooperation or assistance you're seeing, Australia?
Good question too. So we've done a lot in the region over the last 6 months, and there's much more to come in the next 3 years. So in December last year, our Prime Minister announced $500 million package to assist the countries of Southeast Asia, including the Philippines. And out of those monies, the Philippines gets the second largest portion. So it's very significant what's coming into the Philippines with Australia's assistance. And as you'll be aware, Australia is the vice chair of the Gavi Alliance. So that's the group that determines the priority for COVAX vaccines coming into the country. And yeah. So far there's been four deliveries, over 2,700,000 vaccines, doses that have come into the Philippines as a result, to a great degree, of Australia's advocacy for the Philippines. Hmm. Additional to that, what Australia is also seeking to do is to assist with vaccine acquisition beyond the COVAX facility, but also looking at the logistics of how do you distribute vaccine in the Philippines. So we've been fortunate to have conversations with Secretary Galvez, Secretary Duque, Secretary Dizon, about what does the Philippines actually need from Australia's expertise. So beyond vaccines, what the Philippines needs is logistical support to ensure that the vaccines get to everyone across the 7,000 or more islands of the Philippines. So that's what we're also seeking to contribute. And that's been marvellous. We're also working with the Red Cross and we've established the largest molecular laboratory in the Philippines to assist with testing. And as you rightly say too, we've been working with the UN Population Fund to assist women and girls as they're dealing with the pandemic. So there's lots of activity happening, and the Philippines, like everyone else, is grappling with the issue of vaccine supply. But Australia is no different in that regard, I'm afraid. We're all trying to get more vaccines.
Okay, Mr. Ambassador, it's unfortunate I don't have enough time already. Next time, I do hope to interview you again, speak with you again for a much longer period. But I have one last question. Is Australia open to Philippine tourists at this point? What are the rules?
So at this point, Australia is not open essentially to anyone beyond Australians who need to get into the country to get home. At this point, as you rightly said, we're all trying to vaccinate our complete populations and develop herd immunity. And at this point, we have, except for the New Zealanders, who are a part of our bubble, real limitations on getting into the country. But we want to get there very quickly so that we can open our borders again and we can get all the Filipinos down to Australia and all the Australians back to the Philippines. That's what we're desperate to do. And that's part of our mateship and bayaniha.
Mr. Ambassador, thank you so much for joining me this morning. I hope to see you again. Thank you, sir.
Thanks very much, Karen. My pleasure.